You're tuned in to the Why Sound Works podcast, presented by SoundShock.
Hey everyone, I'm Daniel Strongen, and I want to welcome you to Why Sound Works, a podcast dedicated to helping you become a better music producer by exploring the music production process with professional music producers and industry professionals. This podcast is presented by SoundShockAudio.com, a site dedicated to the modern music producer, where all your music production needs are met with free plugins, presets, samples, loops, and contact instruments, as well as the most comprehensive music production tutorials online. In each episode of Why Sound Works, I chat with music producers from all over the world about how they create their music, starting from the first mini note all the way to the mastering stage, as well as having a chat about their career, touring, and the current state of the music industry. In episode number one, I interview the talented electronic pop and future-based production duo Naxxos. They share tons of tips, tricks, and advice on working with vocalists, how they evolve their sound, the importance of music theory, how to get your music heard, how they finish their tracks, and discuss how the loudness wars are over. Once again, this podcast is to help all music producers, so I'd love to hear what you guys all think about this podcast. Feel free to reach out to me on Instagram at SoundShock Audio, or you can leave a rating and review on iTunes, or you can contact me on the SoundShockAudio.com website. And don't forget to subscribe to the Why Sound Works podcast on iTunes so you get every episode that I release downloaded straight to your device. It is time now for you to sit back, relax, and enjoy the podcast as we explore modern music production. So for everyone who doesn't know about the Naxxos project, what is it about? How did you guys start? And what got you to where you are today?
Wow.
That's a long story.
That was a lot there. That was a lot.
big first question.
That's a big first question.
In fact, we actually met in school because like he was two grades above me. And we were both producing drum and bass at that time.
Yeah, we all had our own little separate projects. And I don't know, we just heard each other's music and we were like, hey, I've heard your shit. Oh, shit, can I swear?
Who cares? You can't now.
And we were like, oh, I've heard your songs and let's do music together or something like that, you know? And it kind of clicked.
Yeah.
Okay, nice. And so how long have you guys been a duo?
Eight years probably.
Yeah.
Oh wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Pretty long time now.
And you guys said you started with drum and bass, and you know,
exactly.
The tracks that you release on this project, you know, are more of like the future bass electronic pop.
True.
You know, how did you get from drum and bass to there?
We still kind of feel that we're going back to our roots because like we actually got known doing tropical house.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
pretty much.
Like after 2 or 3 years, we thought of doing a switch back to our roots kind of, and future bass was a thing at that time and it kind of worked and it kind of reminds you of drum and bass in some kind of sense, if you know what I mean.
It's more bassy. That's
more
about
bassy
it.
Than, yeah, exactly.
And,
okay.
and less four to the floor-y.
I gotcha.
Exactly.
I gotcha. So how did, you know, you get into the more like melodic style, you know, from a, you know, grimier, you know, dub drum and bass type sound?
Like in the first place?
Yeah. How did you guys, you know, create the project? Well, what was the inspiration for it?
Well, when we switched away from our initial projects, which were drum and bass, we felt like, you know what, just like, fuck it. We're fed up with all this bass music and simplicity with it. Let's do some like super poppy
melodic house,
you know, and we just started it, you know, for shits and giggles, you know.
Okay.
And we kind of got famous with it, so that's how we got into melodic, you know. And after that we tried to evolve our sound and now we're kind of in that future bass genre. It's hard to explain. It happened.
Okay, so you're kind of more just drawn to kind of the more melodic side of, you know, electronic music after just being fed up with, you know.
Generally speaking, yeah.
And how did you guys kind of, you know, start, you know, the project? How did you decide, you know, this is kind of the future bass sound that I want to, you know, create? Was it just inspiration from other artists? Was it just kind of just messing around and be like, oh, this, you know, kind of sounds cool?
Well, I think I like the change to future bass actually like happened 1.5 years ago, I'd say, or like 2 years ago, or like over the past 2 years, kind of. And like from song to song, it just kind of developed to be more not housey, if you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. And then at that time, it was like Flume was a big deal at that time. And you also get inspired by that sound, of course, and kind of just like change your sound more and more until it just ends up being that what it is. I don't know.
Okay. Nice. So, you know, in your tracks, you know, you have great melodies, you have great, you know, chord progressions. You know, how do you guys go about writing those? Because they're such a huge part of your guys' tracks. So, you know, what's kind of the creative process, the technical process, whatever process that you guys go through, kind of how do you, you know, go about that?
That's a tough one.
all the tough questions on this podcast.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, I guess, I mean, every song kind of, I don't know, is there a recipe? I think every song started in a different way. You know,
yeah,
sometimes you start with the riff, for example, and you're like, okay, that's a really nice riff. Like, you've got the chords and that's it. And you add some drums and everything comes together. And later on, you get a singer and they write a top line together with you. And it's just a fit. And sometimes you already get the top line and then you build the track around it, you know. So it's different from track to track.
Okay. Exactly.
Gotcha. Are you guys
like at some parts you're just gonna start with a piano loop or whatever and just build the whole thing around it, and that's it actually. You just build and build until it's done.
Okay. Yeah. Are you guys classically trained at all? Do you guys have any experience with music theory? Because that's, you know, a really big topic with electronic producers. It's, you know, do they know music theory? You know, some a lot don't, from what I've been seeing. And it doesn't really seem to matter.
I don't know.
Well, I'd say like good electronic music producers all know their music theory, I'd say. Like,
yeah, that's pretty true.
Like, you don't have to know like music theory, but you should.
You don't
like,
have to be Jacob.
Music. You don't have to music. You know music. That's all there is to it, I guess.
Right. I think you don't have to be someone like, I don't know, Jacob Collier to make good electronic music. You know, you gotta get the gist of it.
I got you. Gotta have that foundation.
All
the basics. You know of it.
You just have to know what sounds good and what sounds wrong, and you know how how to build chords, how to make chord progressions. You have to know how melodies work, but that stuff just comes with
tension. How to resolve everything, you know.
Like if you kind of like learn an instrument, for example, it's gonna take you 3 years, and you got the gist of it, kind of, you know.
Okay.
Just practice, I'd say.
I gotcha. You know, that's a huge thing. You know, producers are so impatient these days. They just, you know, want to make a big hit right now after they've been producing for a year, right? It seems like, you know, a lot of music production, it's all ear training. You know, what sounds good to, you know, your ears? What's, you know, just finding what combination of sounds, you know, the notes. You know, do you have any advice for these impatient producers?
Keep going.
Keep going.
It's really... thing is, when we both started, like, our separate journeys into electronic music, we've had like classic music experience prior to that. I think Chris was in a band and I used to have piano lessons for a few years when I was younger, so we had our foundation, you know. So when we got into making electronic music, we'd already been like clubbing and we know the scenes and how electronic music was supposed to sound, you know.
Okay. So
if you got those two foundations, it's quite easy. You just go on YouTube and look for some tutorials how to recreate sound, you know?
The rest is actually just sound design.
And you can learn sound design
from tutorials.
Exactly. Tutorials, they're like essential. I mean, back when we started, there weren't that many YouTube tutorials available. There were a few guys who used to upload regularly who delivered really good content. And I think nowadays there's so much content, even by professional outlets. It's crazy. So I think if you don't put some effort into it and like just go on YouTube or wherever and educate yourself and train yourself, you're not going to make it, you know. You have to put some work into it, you know.
Exactly.
Right. Too many lazy producers out there.
Yeah.
I just want to make a big hit.
I mean, I think the wrong approach is, I've seen so many guys when we were touring who were just like, you know, little DJs, and they were trying to come out big. So they thought like, yo, I'm going to go to DJ school, and then I'm going to be a producer and I'm going to have a huge hit. And I felt like, yeah, probably not, right? So, yeah.
So the knowledge is all there. It's all online. It's all on YouTube, yeah. Pretty much.
You just have to go for it, you know.
And if you decide to learn an instrument, it's even better.
Yeah, exactly.
It's gonna go more easily.
Would you recommend any specific instruments?
Yeah,
like piano to learn.
Well, piano you're gonna learn the whole theory, but it's tough. Like if you just want to like understand the basics, you can learn the guitar like in 2 years, I'd say.
Yeah.
But piano is gonna take like a lot longer.
Okay, I gotcha.
Sure.
So you mentioned you guys have a lot of, you know, work with a lot of vocalists. When I think all your songs have vocalists on them. A lot of producers can be kind of confused with like the vocal, you know, collaboration process. So how do you guys work with vocalists? Are you sending, you know, a basic structure over and just bouncing ideas back and forth? Are you sending over a complete song? Does it vary? You know, how does that kind of work, the collaboration? Both?
Pretty much both, yeah.
Well, like for example, what like we've been to London last year and 2 years ago as well, and that's where we like met up with a few singers for a week in a studio and just jammed out and just tried to see what happens, and we kind of wrote some top lines together and they all turned out pretty good. So like meeting up with the person always works better than collaborating over the internet, I'd say.
True.
But both is fine. Both works.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And do you guys write lyrics with the vocalist as well?
We have. We're really bad lyricists.
Yeah. We were like coming up with rhymes like house rhymes with mouse, right?
Yeah.
That's going in the song.
Yeah, but that's pretty, yeah, pretty much it.
Okay, nice. And is it a lot of back and forth? You know, with the artist, you kind of refining the idea and sending it back to them, and then, you know, them saying, okay, you know, maybe, you know, this can, you know, be sounding a bit better, or kind of, you know, I guess there's a lot of back and forth going with the vocalist.
Not really, actually.
No, if you like what Chris was talking about earlier, when we go to London for writing camps and stuff like that, we got a lot of time with the singers to like really finish the top line and get it into the box and record everything, you know. Back and forth would be the approach to take when it's online, like when you just get something, write them some feedback, and wait 2 weeks till you get the new version.
Yeah, that would mean that they would have to like book 4 or 5 different sessions in the studio, which would be so expensive and which wouldn't be really productive.
And if you're in the same room, you can give feedback instantaneous, you know. It's like, that's shit, that's great, and you can adapt like in a matter of minutes, you know.
Okay,
exactly.
That's the great advantage of it.
Gotcha. And how are you guys finding these vocalists? You mentioned you went to London for a specific, you know, camp. Is it with the labels? You know, just kind of searching people on SoundCloud.
So far, it's been organized by our management.
Okay,
like Unity Group in France. They've been organizing that, and they've brought some artists, and we looked on SoundCloud and told them like, hey, could you write these people? Maybe they could come. That's, for example, how we got Rafaela.
Okay. Just messaging her.
We wanted her. Yeah, no, we found, you know, we were Googling like people, not Googling, we were browsing SoundCloud, you know, like London-based artists on SoundCloud, and we're browsing like how they sounded, and was like, oh, Rafaela, she's nice. Let's see whether she's interested, you know. And then she came, and it was a perfect match, I guess.
So, you know, progressing more with vocals.
And now I'm breaking off.
Oh, you froze. I can still hear
you,
though.
You froze with a smile.
Yeah, you froze with a smile. It's a good freeze. It's not one of those, you know, where you're like, ah. There we go. So, you know, more with vocals, you know, vocal processing. is really tough for a lot of producers. You know, getting the vocals to sit right in the mix, knowing what levels to get them at. Do you have any, you know, specific, you know, mixing, you know, tips for getting the vocals, you know, front and center in the mix and nice and clean? Well,
I'd say like the classic process would be like to use a good compressor, like to do the right amount of compression, add a filter, add a saturator, maybe like kind of spice up the whole thing with whatever, with an exciter. That's the classic approach.
Just a classic approach.
I was gone there for a minute, so I don't know what we're talking about, but it sounds legit.
How would we bring the vocals in the center of the mix?
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, kind of just the process.
Don't overuse reverb, because overusing reverb like
generally
fucks up the whole mix.
Okay. And do you have any specific reverbs that you guys like to use, and reverbs and delays for vocals that sound good to your ears?
The Fab Filter reverb is pretty cool. If you know that one.
Yes. Yes.
How's that basic reverb from Pro Tools called?
I don't know.
Not sure. That's either a good question. Right now.
No, whatever. That one.
That one. Okay.
That one with the church presets. I like that one.
Okay. Are you guys both on Pro Tools?
We're just Ableton.
Audio editing is on Pro Tools and producing is on Ableton.
Yeah, it seems Pro Tools is kind of the standard for recording.
Audio, like if you want to edit audio and cut audio, like how do you say comp audio?
Yeah, comp audio. That's just
works pretty good in Pro Tools.
Yeah, Ableton. Yeah. Ableton's pretty shitty at that.
Yeah.
great for writing.
Exactly.
You know, working with Ableton, have you guys used any other DAWs besides, you know, like Logic, FL Studio? You know, why do you guys kind of like Ableton?
Yeah, we started with Reason.
started with Reason?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, Reason 4 back then, or Reason 3, I don't know.
Wow, I can't remember, but it was hilarious.
Yeah.
I kind of miss Reason.
Really?
No, I don't.
Like, not really, but kind of.
Well, I mean, they have VSTs now.
Yeah, they do.
I'm like, you know, nostalgic with all the wires and the rack. Yeah. You know, it's like
just being able to work in the box, not even being able to load audio files properly.
Really? Yeah. Like, is that bad?
Like, I remember, like I always imported audio files via the drum sampler because audio track.
I know.
How is that possible?
That was so weird.
On like Reason 3 or 4?
Yeah, exactly.
That's really old.
Yeah, but still.
I don't know.
It's pretty standard to have be able to load audio into a DAW, even if it's
10 years ago.
And it's a while ago. It's crazy. It's crazy how software.
I think it was possible, but we weren't able to get Rewire or whatever running.
Yeah, whatever. What was it? Whatever.
It was like a second part of Reason, which we never really understood.
Probably. It probably was possible, kind of.
Complex, more complex than it needed to be.
Exactly. Yeah.
I feel like, though, being in Reason, you know, having kind of that limited set of tools kind of helps you just know your tools really well.
True. Know,
there's just so much, there's so many plugins out there today. There's way too many.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, do you guys have like a dedicated set of tools that, you know, or you're consistently using every track?
Kind of.
Wait, I got my computer open, actually. Isotope, nice. Ozone, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay.
For Serum.
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 Massive LFO tool.
LFO tool, X-Fair.
Pretty cool. A lot of transient shaper.
A lot of the basic Ableton plugins too.
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely.
I gotcha.
Sure. They're pretty good, most of them.
Right. How are you guys liking 10 so far? Are you guys on 10? Ableton 10?
Not officially yet.
Not officially?
Like, we're on 9 right now, but we're going to switch to 10 like in a few days, I guess.
Okay.
We're like in the middle of finishing some tracks, which we started on 9, and we're like, never change our running system.
Right, yeah.
Until the tracks are done.
Yeah. You don't want to do that.
We're not upgrading.
I think you guys will really like 10. The workflow improvements are
groups.
How insane is that? Like,
best decision ever.
How did Ableton not have that?
Yeah. Insane thinking about it. And there's another feature I really like. If you're now in the browser view and you're opening an old session file, you can take out the whole group, not just the single tracks.
Oh, really?
So you get the whole group with the bass. That's really good, because sometimes I am like, you know, if you're layering synthesizers and stuff like that, and you want to take a synthesizer from another project with all its layers and reuse it or like tweak it, you'd have to take every single layer out of the old project and drag it into the new one, and then maybe do a new group and add new effects and stuff. And now you can drag in the whole new group.
Right. That's amazing.
Right.
Amazing, yeah.
It finally stepped up its game. Kind of going, you know, back to more of your specific tracks. I've also noticed that in your songs, you guys have a lot of little ear candy sounds. You know, you of course have, you know, big vocals, you know, the, you know, future bass synths and, you know, the melodies. But you also have like a lot of ear candy in there. You know, how do you guys decide kind of what goes in there? Any specific, you know, sample packs, any specific techniques? A lot of, you know, amateur tracks.
Good question.
A lot of amateur tracks, they'll have, you know, a melody, a chord progression, some effects, but it still feels empty. So I guess, how do you guys fill out your tracks?
Well, Foley's, for one.
Okay.
So we browse a lot on freesound.org.
Is freesound.org just a bunch of just Foley samples?
Nah, I was
there's
kidding.
A lot of do you know samples up there, but there's like some samples you can use. Like if you need some wood blocks or whatever, you can just get them for free, and they're like royalty free. If you got to check the license though.
Yeah. Okay. Some are like, how's it called?
Free for personal use or whatever.
Creative Commons or no commercial use and stuff like that. So sometimes we'd be browsing it, looking for, I don't know, the atmosphere of a park or like a food court. And then you're like, I'm going to take this atmosphere and put it in. And you're like, shit, it's not, you're
too
not
risky.
A, it's too risky. Yeah.
Gotcha. It's a bomb.
Yeah. Sure. And I don't know.
It's a lot of vocal.
But I think what a really great tip is actually to think about it. Like if you really want to add some cool licks on the sides or whatever, like some percussion fills, transient designers work really well nowadays. You can like make everything pop out really well.
Okay.
So like before I'd use a compressor to pimp up a snare, I'd use a transient designer because it just works so much better.
Okay.
Mm.
Like if you want to like add some snap to claps or whatever, you want to add some snaps. And you can even like, if you have like a really roomy clap and you want to delete the room of the clap, you can just add a transient designer and like like turn the release to zero, and you've got like no release and no room at all. Like if you just want to have a really short, snappy sound.
Okay, so you can really shape the sound that way. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a nice tip.
So concerning free sound, you know, it's just like that library that's been online for I don't know decades, so it's like the OG open source whatever.
Is that the one, you know, is that the one with the yellow like waveforms? And like the black background.
You know, if you wanna do proper stuff, you know, you've gotta go to like commercial sites like SoundShock, for example.
There you go. Go to SoundShock.
For example. Yeah, I just checked it. It's the one with the yellow.
Okay. Yeah, I definitely know that one. Actually, right now I'm trying to get together the largest free sample library online right now. That's taking forever. So I just go through all the different sites that have free samples and just link them up.
Wow.
That's
crazy.
I think that will.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah, an insane amount. I feel like my eyes are just bleeding every day from doing it.
maybe you should get some really, really smart IT guys who write you a bot. But that's going to be a bit complicated, I guess.
That would be a bit complicated, yeah.
maybe you should hit up Google.
Yeah, I should. More Google searching. I feel that's the answer to most things. That's the answer to life, is just Google things. So I wanted to touch on another topic that's, you know, a hot topic, if you will, in production. Mastering. Do you guys master your own tracks?
Not anymore, actually.
Do you guys have a label to it? Do you send it out to mastering service?
We have our own mixing guy in Vienna, our mastering guy.
And you send him all your tracks?
Yeah.
Like for the latest six tracks we sent him. Like before we actually did our own mastering, but what like for the last, for the whole EP that we recently released, we said, okay, let's just let somebody else do the mastering, because our ears are bleeding. Like, it's kind of impossible to master your own tracks.
Okay. You need a new set of ears, you know?
I feel like it's such a different process that it's just, you know, once you've listened to your song so much, it's like you can't, you know,
exactly
take off the shades, you know, the glasses, you know, of seeing it that way, almost.
Exactly. For example, we'd be listening, like cross-listening to our final mixes compared to the new masters, and we were like, oh my god, the last mix didn't have enough mids and stuff like that, you know? Just general stuff.
Do you guys do anything to your tracks to prepare for the mastering? Do you have, you know, your song at a certain level? Do you have any specific, you know, do you have any compression?
Yeah,
pre-master?
Well, you gotta leave the right amount of headroom, of course. Like, if you send it to mastering, you can't, like, put the volume up to, like, I don't know, like, zero decibel digital scale. You gotta, like, you still gotta leave some headroom for the mastering guy, because he's gonna push up the volume anyway. So,
or what are you referring to? That we have like every stem at the same level, because the mix, we're doing the mix, so the master is
okay. No, I just make kind of just what you have on like the pre-master before you send it on over. To them.
Well, like if he opens, like we send him 8 stems, he's gonna do a stem mastering, and if when he opens those 8 stems, it's going to sound exactly like our mix.
Okay.
Exactly.
So we're going to export everything. Like, we're going to group all the drums. We're going to group, like, we always have the kick and the snare separately because it's easiest that way. But for all the rest of the percussion, all the cymbals, and there's a synth section, there's a bass section and everything. So we're going to have like 8 stems or 8 to 9 stems in the end.
One stem with the hall.
Okay.
Exactly. Plus 3 reverb returns.
Exactly.
So you guys do a lot of return and send channels in your tracks.
That's the easiest way.
You guys have...
And the cheapest, like CPU-wise, it's the cheapest way.
Do you guys have, like, you said a couple different reverbs set up on? Like, you know, what are your return and sends looking like on your tracks?
Let's say return 1 is reverb, return 2 is...
delay.
Triplet delay, return 4 is a normal, how do you say it? I don't know.
Just ping pong delay?
Great delay, for example.
Okay. Oh, so you use a triplet delay?
No, just for instance, so you have like 2 different delay returns because the one is a triplet, the other one is a normal one, for example. And so you can switch between if you want to.
Okay, nice. That's a good,
like,
tip.
You can
there.
Send a wood percussion, you could send through the triplet delay because that sounds really nice. If you have a straight beat and a wood triplet going through, and you'd send the vocals through the normal delay, for example.
I also have to ask this question about mastering. The loudness wars. Are you guys... Where are
it's
you guys
over.
On that?
It's over. It's over. It's over. Spotify ended the loudness war.
With their...
Because like they decided to like to dramatically reduce the maximum volume on Spotify. And Spotify is kind of the world right now. So they kind of ended the loudness war. So it doesn't really make sense to overmaster a track anymore if you want to release it on Spotify.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so like no cranking it anymore.
Yeah, it's not worth it.
Yeah.
I prefer dynamic songs anyway.
Exactly.
How, you know, loud is your tracks when you get it back from mastering?
It is loud, but it's not that loud.
Okay.
Like,
I'm not sure.
I couldn't tell you right now, but I guess it's like -1.
I think sometimes even -3. I'm not sure, but you might be right.
And that's crazy how like Spotify is the thing now. You got to have all your music on Spotify.
It's insane. It's insane how quickly the industry changed.
You know, it's kind of, you know, SoundCloud is still there,
but not really.
Yeah, but not really. You know, it's really all about Spotify. Do you guys get on your music on certain playlists? Do you just have, you know, kind of your team put up your music on Spotify?
Pretty much.
Okay.
Pretty much.
Do you get it on any certain playlists on Spotify? Because those playlists are huge.
We try to target certain playlists just because it helps your views. It just helps you get more clicks.
Exposure.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Like some of those playlists, I mean, they have millions of followers and they get a crazy amount of plays every day. So, you know, another problem with, you know, producers, it's like, you know, you have to do everything these days. It seems like, you know, it's not just the music. You have to, you know, also promote your music and market your music and be on social media. That's, you know, exactly. Such a huge one. You know, how do you guys handle social media? Like, what are your opinions on it?
Barely.
So tough.
Barely.
So it's tough.
It used to be so easy, you know, when we started, we had like three pretty decent tracks. We put them online on SoundCloud, shared them to almost every group there was on SoundCloud, which was a pretty good feature back then to promote your music. Mm-hmm. And then we just had our Facebook page and we just posted statistics and said, thank you guys. That was it.
That's literally it.
And now if we want to release a new track, we have our agency who's getting a PR agency, who's in turn contacting our distributor, who's in turn contacting these guys who are like curating Spotify playlists. At the same time, we have to handle like Facebook,
Instagram.
SoundCloud,
we Instagram, have to whip up those Instagram stories all the time.
It's insane.
So how are you guys coming up with like Instagram stories or just your content in general? Like how much of it is like music and how much of it is it just...
We're the wrong people to ask that question because we could ask you that question. How do you come up with proper content?
Well, okay.
I think it's hard not to feel like, you know, like an idiot or phony, you know, because you're known for doing music, you know, and obviously we aren't in the studio every day and obviously we're on touring every day. So when I'm posting, you know, just today I posted a photo of food, you know, mm-hmm. and it's not related to our music and I feel like an idiot posting it. You
I saw that. That looked really good though.
Yeah, it was good, you know.
What cheeses were that? What cheeses did you eat?
It was like 2 goat cheese, brie.
Okay, nice.
Some more Austrian cheese. It was good. It was good. But that's not the point, you know. We should, you know, be forced to do that. But I guess it's part of the game now.
Yeah, it seems like it's part of the game. It's like, you know, the audience wants to be like a part of your lives now. They want to see everything that's going on. They want to, you know, feel connected to you. So it's, I guess, you know, all artists seem like they're doomed, at least for now, to be sharing, you know, more than just, I guess, music stuff.
I mean, there are people like Will Smith who just owns Instagram, you know, but I don't know. Have you seen his account?
Will Smith?
Yeah.
No, I haven't. I watched some of his vlogs, though.
He recently started Instagram, I think. I'm not sure, though. Don't quote me on that. And it's fucking hilarious. And it's just
funny.
But
like,
he's an
videos.
Actor, you know.
Yeah, he's an actor. Yeah, he's Will Smith.
He knows how to do that. So we aren't, you know.
Yeah,
yeah.
It's true. You know, it comes a lot more natural to a lot of other people.
Mm-hmm.
You know, especially I guess for the introverted artists. You know, doing the whole social media thing and sharing everything is just. It's like, I don't want to do that. I guess how do you balance? I guess kind of releasing, you know, a cheese platter versus your music. It's like how many posts, you know, for your music, you know, promoting your music versus just other posts, kind of whatever comes to mind at that point.
No, I don't really like, we try to do a lot of in the studio posts, kind of like, and if we don't really know what to post, then we're going to post like some food photo or like us doing sports or whatever, you know.
The thing is,
we do try to focus on proper content that
exactly
really relates to music, I'd say.
Yeah.
Are you trying to do like one a day, like posting, that sort of thing?
No,
one a day.
Yeah,
no, that's a lot. Like, we have like two or three a week.
I gotcha.
maybe not.
We try
to do like a lot. Follow us on Instagram, you know. We do a lot of stories, you know. We don't post a lot, but we do a lot of stories.
What's your Instagram handle?
Oh, yeah, it's...
Instagram music.
At Naxxos _ music.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Naxxos _ music.
It's so embarrassing. Like we both don't really know our Instagram handle. So follow us at Naxxos _ music. It's Naxxos with 2 X.
There you go. Follow us under the account that I don't know. How do other people pronounce your artist name?
Oh, yeah, it's like, interesting.
We've heard Nachos a lot of times.
Nachos?
Narcos.
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 I don't know why.
Naxxos is pretty cool.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it's like it's meant to be like Naxxos or Naxxos.
Okay.
Depending, we're not really, we haven't decided.
How did you come up with that name?
Feel free.
Summer, I don't know. You tell it. I don't know.
You guys don't remember?
Is
that a drunken night?
That just happened. The thing is, Naxxos is like it's a Greek island, you know. It's like Naxxos with an X. So I always liked Greece. So did Chris, you know. And we wanted to do a project that kind of has a summery vibe. So that's the sound we started with, like this tropical house, you know.
Okay.
And the second X was just for symmetry, you know. A bit ambiguous because it can be seen as like the X's are redacting something. For example, a C and an H for Naxxos.
Yeah.
Oh, R and C for Narcos.
There you go. So multiple meanings for the name.
Yeah. Quite interesting. Wasn't on purpose, but...
I wanted to go over kind of one more, you know, thing about kind of marketing and branding. A lot of producers, you know, just starting out, they don't have connections, you know, they don't have management, they don't have, you know, all of that, and they want to get their music heard. How did you guys, in the beginning stages, get your music heard? The landscape now is a bit different than from when you guys, you know, were starting making music. I guess, you know, kind of just what advice, you know, would you give to people looking to get their music heard?
I think YouTube channels might be a way to go. Like, submit them to a lot of YouTube channels. I think they're going to listen to the music. And if they post your song, it's going to reach a few hundred thousand clicks. Mm-hmm. Then you're good to go, actually. I don't know.
I'm not sure.
Good work.
How did you guys, you know, when you started?
For us, it wasn't that easy either, you know? You know, back then, YouTube channels already existed, you know, like UKF drum and bass and stuff like that. I think it was impossible to directly go there and get exposure. So you had to have SoundCloud. But now that SoundCloud is, it's not the same anymore, you know, it's really hard.
Back then, everything happened via SoundCloud because our tracks exploded on SoundCloud, then they got uploaded on YouTube.
Okay.
And that's magic thing.
So that's kind of where it started. It was SoundCloud. You just got just uploading and then just...
Exactly.
Were you guys promoting? Were you like messaging other artists and saying, you know,
kind of promoting the track like by posting them in groups. Like SoundCloud groups. But that's it, kind of.
Back when SoundCloud had groups, you know, you remember?
That was a while ago.
That was the greatest feature SoundCloud ever had. And after they kind of patched that out, SoundCloud kind of got worse and worse.
I'm not sure why they just got rid of that. I mean, that's so helpful.
That killed the community vibe, you know?
Yeah, that was definitely community. Turn
it into a streaming platform rather than a community platform.
Right.
Yeah, it's a pity.
Yeah, that's really what SoundCloud was built on, kind of that community. And I guess that's kind of why it's just kind of fallen off slowly from there. I guess just trying to compete with all the other streaming services.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. But it's a pity, you know, because they had their own thing. I think SoundCloud was never supposed to, or was never meant to compete with Spotify or Amazon Music or whatever. They had their own thing going and they ruined it by trying to emulate the others.
SoundCloud was unique within itself when it, you know, first came onto the scene. When I don't know when that was, like over a decade ago or 10 years ago? I don't even remember.
About 10 years ago, I guess.
It seems like it's longer than that. It's been longer than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe.
Could be.
Probably, yeah.
Speaking about kind of labels and kind of blogs, you know, do you have any tips for artists kind of, you know, trying to send their music out? You know, it's a lot easier when you know labels and you have those connections. Labels get so much music sent to them every day. And, you know, they can only pick so many songs. Do you have any, you know, tips for sending music out to labels?
I don't know if that works. I don't know. But I think like the only recipe there is do the right music at the right time and you will be heard. And do it right, you know, like make proper music at the right time.
Okay,
if your sound is good and it works and it has the right vibe of the current time, I don't know, it might work, you know.
And be yourself, be original, be yourself and be original.
Of course.
I gotcha.
But your sound has to be right, you know, like if you want to release a heavy metal album right now, it's probably not going to work. I don't know. Like, okay, it's totally different. That's a bad example, but
depends on the scene.
Yeah, I guess it depends on the scene.
Of course, yeah. Right? Of course.
And I feel like there's kind of like a fine line when people send their music out to labels, is because they, you know, will oftentimes just copy a song that's already on the label.
True.
And if you do something a little too different, then they kind of won't accept it. So it's kind of like you have to be kind of similar, but still kind of original.
Exactly. Almost. Exactly. Yeah. Like, do the current vibe, but be your own
master.
Be your own master.
Yeah.
Just take the influence, yeah, I guess. Don't,
yeah, I mean, don't never cater to an audience or an outlet. If you're doing music, for example, I don't know, if you're doing future bass, for example, yeah, don't try to emulate what's out there already. Try to do your own thing. But then in the next step, when your track is finished, don't send it to labels that don't release future bass, for example, you know. Don't send it to a Berlin techno label. That doesn't make sense, you know.
A lot of producers do that.
But I mean, it's obvious, you know.
A lot of producers still do that.
I'm not sure. I hope not.
They definitely do. That definitely happens. Techno guys will get a future bass song every now and then.
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, it's a tough thing because we actually don't know how to tackle it, because we, like most other guys out there, just got lucky, you know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, okay. So you're the lucky guys.
Yeah. We are.
Just kind of put your music out and, you know, the right people listen to it at the right time.
Exactly.
Probably, yeah.
Okay. You guys mentioned you have management. Who else is part of your team?
Our managers are booking agency at the same time. So they're actually our team.
When did when did you guys get management? When did you decide that it was, you know, it was time to get management? Or did someone reach out to you?
They told us it's time to get a management.
And you're like, okay, I believe you guys.
Yeah, exactly. That's how it happens.
Where can I sign?
At what point was this? How many years ago was this?
Early on, 5 years ago.
Okay.
A few months after we released our tracks on SoundCloud.
Okay. And so, after the Tropical House track that you had?
Mm-hmm.
And that's after that exploded, then they're like, oh, you know, you could use some management.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, nice. And you guys been touring, you know, a lot lately?
Not that much, actually.
Not that much?
Barely, much. To be honest.
Barely, yeah. But it's all right. We had some time to focus, on our new sound, and it's good.
Okay,
that's
nice.
That's our main priority right now.
Okay, yeah. Working on new tracks. Are you guys working on, an EP?
Again,
we just
released
one, actually.
You just released one?
Yeah, 2 months ago.
Okay.
Probably.
Okay. I thought you meant now.
Oh, yeah. No.
I was like, how did I miss that?
No.
You said we're focusing on kind of a new sound.
That new sound. That's already kind of the new sound, but we want to further develop it, you know?
Okay. Nice. And is that you said a new EP you were also working on, just a collection of songs?
Probably, yeah.
Probably could be.
Okay. Any release dates? At all?
Not really. Maybe.
Nothing at all.
Nothing yet.
Nothing yet. We're in the middle of finishing the tracks, so let's see.
Okay.
Nothing set in stone yet.
I always feel that, you know, it's like when you're working on a bunch of songs, it's always undetermined time, when they're all going to be finished. It's kind of when it's right. You know, how long do you guys usually spend on a song?
A lot of time.
Are we talking a month here? Are we talking months?
Way longer months, I guess. But it's sometimes, you know, you have the basic structure of the song, mm-hmm. and then you let it rest for a few weeks or months, and then you get to the writing camp and you write a top line on it, and then it rests another few weeks, and then you restart working on it, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it just drags on like that.
We take our time.
Yeah.
Is that kind of, you know, what works best for you guys? I take it, letting it kind of sit. I don't know.
I mean, we both have our, you know, separate lives apart from Naxxos, so there's that too, you know.
Not just in the computer all day, every day, nerding out. How do you guys work together? Do you guys just send each stuff back and forth?
Pretty much, yeah.
It's just, you know, just like you'll start.
We share a Dropbox. We share a Dropbox, and Max uploads 1.1. I upload 1.2. Then you. Works on 1.3, for example.
I feel like
so we just play ping pong.
I feel like, you know, I feel like that, you know, having someone else to work with is kind of everything. It's like you could easily get so stuck, you know, and just have a track just sit there for, you know, months. How do you know when a track's kind of done? Is there just like a checklist that you have? It's like, you know, does this hit this emotion? Does this, you know, is there anything like that? Or just, you know, it just feels right and you know it's ready to go.
I don't know. It's like I think everybody knows when his own song is done. Like if you really feel, oh, it's, I like it the way it is, then I guess it's done.
Okay.
Probably somebody else is going to say, hey, why don't you add some more whatever? And you're going to be like, oh, wait, I didn't even consider that. Then you're going to do that. And then you're like, oh, now it's finished, you know?
I always feel like there's endless tweaking that can be done.
There is. And that's the problem.
That's a really big one.
Yeah. How do you just cut that off? You're like, okay, I'm not, like, it's done. Like it.
we don't.
The endless tweaking continues. I really feel that the time, like letting it sit there for a month, letting it sit there for a couple of weeks, it kind of is everything. It's like once you listen to that song, it's almost like, you know, for so many times, it's almost like you see it differently, and you want to see it, you know, unbiased, but you can't help it because it's just you've listened to it. Your brain is just so used to it.
Exactly. So letting it sit for a few weeks is like a good strategy we use sometimes because it refreshes your ears, you know. You kind of forget the song and then you start working on it again and you're like, okay, that's a pretty decent track, but that and that has to be changed, you know. But 4 weeks before that, you were like, oh my God, this song is perfect, you know.
Do you guys usually have like a rotation of tracks that you're working on that you kind of just go through? Like 3 tracks, 4 tracks, or just however many, you know, at the time?
Let's say like normally 2 tracks maybe at the same time at the max.
Okay. I don't know. At some point. We usually have a rotation, right? But when it's time to finish one track, it's just that track for a few weeks.
And as far as like unfinished projects, how many unfinished projects do you guys have on your hard drives?
Handful.
Like 3 times as many as we released.
Oh, that's what you meant?
Yeah, just like all unfinished.
That are never going to see the daylight?
Yes, those projects.
Hundreds.
Hundreds, definitely.
Yeah.
Every producer has that, I feel like.
Yeah. I got I never told you, I archived all our Dropboxes because sometimes we go crazy and we're like, okay, you know what, let's do a clean slate and delete all of our like project files and restart our Dropbox and start from the beginning. Mm-hmm. And I have like Dropbox Archive 1, 2013, Dropbox Archive 2, 2014. And there's so much trash in there. It's insane.
Well, it's pretty funny though.
Yeah,
that's a lot of project files. Do you ever go back and like just rip out some sounds from them, or just use anything from them at all?
Only from the ones that made it to daylight for me.
Well, I feel the same.
So how do you guys know when a track's not gonna make it? It's like, you know, obviously when you sit down, you want it to
sucks,
make it.
You know when a track sucks,
and you just cut it. You're just like, okay, this is, I'm over
like,
it.
It just doesn't make you happy. It's like
it's gotta have that vibe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of producers ask, you know, so many questions, you know, a lot of more inexperienced producers are like, you know, how did you get to, you know, that specific level? And, you know, it's all about, you know, I feel like, once again, going back to ear training, knowing what you like, knowing what sounds good to you.
And it's all about ear training.
And developing it, though, because it's like, you know, your ears, when you first started, you know, the first year of producing, they are not what they are at now. So what you thought sounded good, you know, year one, you know, it sounds like complete crap right now.
I remember our early projects and we were like, wow, that's a really good drum and bass track. You know, like every single track and the master was red, you know, all the way up. Let's go. Classic.
Good times.
Yeah, that's
good times.
It's great times just living in the red.
Wow. Yeah, you're just
living on the edge.
But you learn, right?
Yeah.
We learn.
Yeah, there you go. Are you guys planning on going back to drum and bass at all? Any side projects or just any?
Probably not.
No. You're just done with it.
I mean, if the day should ever come that we're going to release an album, maybe we'll have a track that could be in this BPM range of drum and bass, but it wouldn't be like conventional drum and bass.
In Netsky style, more melodic.
Sure, liquid, but no. I guess, I don't know, maybe.
Do you guys experiment with like other genres right now? Experimenting?
I guess just experimenting, you know.
It's just experimenting. Whatever happens, happens. There's like we got some R&B influences, I'd say.
Yeah.
Which is pretty nice.
You can definitely hear that in your tracks, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, we're trying to right now we're trying to do a blend of R&B, soul, and future bass. But I don't know how long we're going to pursue this idea, you know. Depends.
Are you just kind of more focusing on kind of the chord progressions, maybe roads, instruments?
Yeah, for example, yeah.
What's in the future for you guys? What are you guys planning on? What are your goals for the next, year or so?
Well, release a banger. That would be cool.
Right, release a banger. You got all your guys' tracks on your SoundCloud are bangers right now.
Yeah, cheers, man.
That's really sweet of you.
That's really sweet. Thanks.
I mean, the music speaks for itself, man.
Thanks.
Planning on touring in the near future, in the year or so?
Would be cool. I mean, we'd love to, play the States, but we haven't had the opportunity so far. So let's see if that dream comes true.
Any, dream locations that you'd want to play in the States?
I have no idea, actually. What's cool? I don't know. You tell us.
Los Angeles, man.
yeah, probably.
LA, that'd be where it's at. It's just an incredible amount of nightclubs. Of course, New York City.
New York, yeah. Mm-hmm.
That'd be a lot of fun. Where else? Amazing. I mean, California in general, I would say. Mm-hmm. You'd want to go. But yeah, California in general, I'd definitely recommend any chance you guys can get out to California. I mean, it's not just LA that has a lot of, nightclubs. San Diego, Santa Barbara, all those types of places.
Yeah. So, I reckon Vegas could be fun too. I've never been.
Of course, Vegas. That is one crazy party. Mm-hmm. It's almost like it's like a fantasy land over there. I'll say that.
I imagine.
So, I want to thank you guys for coming on. Why Sound thank Works.
You. Thanks for having us.
I really do appreciate it. And where could we, everyone find you guys? Instagram handles. Go give those out again.
You gotta follow us on Instagram. That's Naxxos_music.
There we go. And the Facebook page, just Naxxos.
Naxxos,
yeah. Okay. Naxxos Music or just Naxxos?
I think you find us if you just search Naxxos.
Yeah, but just search the search bar.
Naxxos. I gotcha.
Or just Google our songs, you'll find everything there.
Just Google us.
Naxxos with a double X. That's
with a double X, yeah. Yeah, I remember typing that into Google and all your stuff popped up. Well, that's going to do it for the very first episode of Why Sound Works. I hope you got plenty of music production tips and tricks from our guests Naxxos today, and you're ready to get into your DAW and start using them. If you would like to hear a particular artist on the podcast, feel free to send an email to me, Daniel Strongen, at daniel@soundshockaudio.com. And I'll get in contact with this artist. Or you can leave a review on iTunes or get in contact with me on Instagram at SoundShockAudio. Also, be sure to check out the number one spot on the web for the modern music producer, SoundShockAudio.com, where all your music production needs are met, as there are free plugins, presets, samples and loops, and contact instruments, as well as the most comprehensive music production tutorials available. And they are all on this site. So check out SoundShockAudio.com. That does it for the very first episode. I'll see you guys next time.